If you run a virtual server or VPS in the cloud, that means in a remote data center of a provider, then your server is exposed to a lot of security risks. In this episode, we will have a look at three really basic settings that you should check or change. If you leave these settings by default, as they come after the installation, then you might effectively be inviting others to take control over your server and maybe use it for dodgy stuff, such as spam mails, etc. I will show you these settings, which greatly increase the security of your VPS and only take 10 minutes to implement. By default, a VPS probably comes with a Linux installed on it, and the provider most probably gives you the root password. Most providers give you root access over some web frontend and over SSH. SSH as such is fine in the sense that it is an encrypted protocol. That means a third party sitting in the middle cannot read what you're doing. However, using SSH with username and password is not the best way of doing things. I have this server here running for a couple of years now, and I can say from the logs that there are hundreds, if not thousands, of people trying to connect to it by trying various combinations of usernames and passwords every single day. If any one of these by chance hacked my root password, then they would have total control over my server and could use it to do basically anything with it, be it sending spam mails or running distributed denial of service attacks against other targets. I don't want this. This is my server. I'm paying for it. So I should have control over it. Okay, let's have a look at two or three really basic settings that we need to take here. The first thing I do is that I create a user account that does not have root privileges. In the future, I will always use this account to do stuff on this server. I can always run sudo in order to become root if needed. If someone hacked into the server, at least they would not have root privileges. Adding a user in Linux is simple. I just need to run the useradd command. Let me do this and create a user called marktest. On the command line, you can specify a couple of options, such as the home directory, which I set to /home/marktest, and a shell, which I set to /bin/bash/bin/bash. The -m option tells Linux to create the home directory. I do not specify a password on the command line because that would be visible on the screen and also be recorded in my bash history file. I rather launch the password command and change the password in a second step. This account should also have the privilege to run things as root using sudo, so I just add it to the group sudo by using the usermod command. Using capital G and minor A as arguments allows me to add the sudo group. Perfect. Now we have a user that can become root as needed, and we don't need to log in with a root account directly anymore. Now let's have a look at SSH security. Before we move on, let's log out and log in as the new user and see if things are working as expected. I can log in using SSH, that's fine. I get a bash shell. Testing sudo asks me for my password and gives me a root shell. Neat, everything works as expected. Now let's have a look at SSH security. The SSH daemon settings are done in the file /etc/ssh-sshd_config. Here we should tweak two settings. Mainly, we need to decide if we want root to be able to connect directly to the server or not. And second, we should disable username password authentication. Now before we do this, and before we generate a key pair to access SSH with public key authentication, let's actually generate and test those keys, so that we don't lock ourselves out. The command to generate a key pair is ssh-keygen. ssh-keygen asks for a password to protect the key. Please note that this is not the password to access the Linux system, but only to protect the key itself. By default, this generates a key called id_rsa in the hidden.ssh subdirectory. We can see there are two files, id_rsa and id_rsa.pub, Let's move the private ID underscore RSA key to the client, either by using FileZilla or WinSCP, or you may just use the cat command to print it out and paste it into a key file on your local workstation. In order to connect using this identity file, you now need to use SSH with the I argument and the key file name. If you're using PuTTY, then you first need to convert the key into a PPK file using the PuTTYGen app. Select Conversion, Import Key, select the key file, and then save the private key. From now on, please leave the SSH session open in case we lock ourselves out. You may need it to revert things. Now, review the SSH settings on the server. We need to check or change the following parameters: permit root login, pub key authentication, Kerberos authentication, challenge response authentication, use PAM, and authorized keys file. Most of these settings should be okay, but let's double check. First, we set all authentication methods to no, except pub key authentication. Permit root login needs to be set to either no or to prohibit password. In essence, you need to decide if you want to be able to connect as root directly. It may be handy if you connect using FileZilla or WinSCP. If you're not planning to do this, then set it to no. If you wanted to connect as root using private public key, then you need to repeat the steps starting with ssh-keygen as root. Depending on how you call the key files, you need to change the authorized keys file setting. Relaunch the sshd daemon by issuing the service sshd restart command and launch PuTTY. Go to connection ssh auth, browse for the new PPK key file, and save the session. You should now be able to connect using key authentication. If this does not work, then do not continue, but double check on all previous steps. Perfect. We have covered non-root user and SSH access. The third area that we need to cover is firewall. Some providers give you a dedicated access in their web frontend to the firewall configuration, where you can open selected ports, for example. As a minimum, you should have TCP port 22 open here, unless you change the TCP port of SSH to something different in the SSHD config file. You may need to open additional ports, depending on the software you run on this system, such as possibly a VPN. If you do not have a frontend provided by the VPS vendor, then the easiest way of locking down firewall on Linux is UFW. UFW uses IP tables and can easily be implemented, as it sets all necessary services to auto-start at boot time. So in order to open TCP port 22, we just need to type UFW22/TCP. Before I do this, let me show you the IP tables rules that exist on the system. There aren't many. Issuing UFW22/TCP and looking at the rules afterwards shows a multitude of rules. That is definitely a thing that you need to keep in mind. Once you use UFW as a frontend, it is quite difficult to manage these rules with anything else. But for a little VPS in the cloud, this should be okay. Great. Now, if I wanted to add port 1194 UDP, all I have to do is type UFW1194/UDP. And that would open the port for, let's say, OpenVPN and so on. Cool. That should be it. We have made the three most important settings for security on a Linux system that everybody should make if they're running a VPS. Of course, there is much, much more that you could do, depending on the level of security that you want to reach. But for a home network environment, we are not too bad at this point. Actually, let me do a short call to action here. I need you to get involved. Please let me know in the comments if you are running a VPS or virtual server or vServer, however you want to call it. I would also love to hear from you if this was useful or not, and I'm especially interested in hearing from you if you would be interested in additional network security videos. One viewer has already expressed the wish to walk through a standard firewall configuration for OpenWRT, for example, with a guest and an IoT network. Maybe there are additional subjects such as securing a network server with a reverse proxy like Nginx or using X.509 client certificates. Let me know what you think in the comments. Thank you very much. In fact, that already concludes today's episode. Please do not forget to leave a thumbs up if you liked the video, do subscribe to my channel, and share this video on social media such as WhatsApp or Twitter. Many thanks for watching. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye for now.